Good morning, and welcome all to Lighthouse Church and its life and ministry of receiving the light, being the light, and sharing the light of Jesus Christ. We are indeed happy to see all of you here today. We welcome you for yet another live service. To those who are watching us via live streaming, we welcome you as well. To those visiting today, we would like to have you accept a welcome gift from us, which is a coffee mug that you can pick up from the small table near the exit as you leave today. We hope you'll return soon to get to know our church family, which we believe is the friendliest church in all of Southwest Florida. To help us connect with you, if you would kindly fill out the connect card that you'll find in your bulletin and place it on the in the offering basket as you exit today, we would appreciate that. Announcements today. As most of you know, our church family was increased this week with the arrival of Ethan Matthew Williams, weighing in at 7 pounds, 1 ounce. He's healthy, and mother's healthy and doing well also. The church family would like to extend congratulations to Joy and Matthew on this most joyous occasion. And Ethan, get ready, pal. You've got more grandparents than you know. In lieu of passing the offering plate today, we would ask that you put your offering in the basket as you exit today. And also, we will not have, again this week, our coffee hour. in respecting the distancing. I would like to say that the work on the church office building is progressing, and the stem wall is nearly complete with a slab to be poured very soon. Once again, I'd like to thank Ross Washanke and the building committee for their many hours of hard work in seeing this project forward in faith, making progress. Today we welcome Reverend Christy Allen Holden as our guest minister. Christy comes to us from Fort Myers, where she is the founder of the Gulf Coast Wesley Foundation. There's a little piece in your bulletin that'll explain the Wesley Foundation. She serves as the director of the foundation and teaches courses at the university as well, and helps with mentoring new clergy among her many duties. Please join me in welcoming Reverend Christy Allen Holden. And now, with the chiming of the Trinity, let's quiet our hearts and minds and prepare for worship in this holy place. Please stand and join in the singing the hymn, We Walk by Faith. Thank you.
pray with me. Holy and gracious God, your steadfast love abides with your people in every age. You teach us to trust in you and call us to live in peace with one another. Show us the way to live grateful lives without fear, knowing the true worth of your creation, including ourselves. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Please join in the prayer of illumination. Loving Father, pour into our hearts that most excellent gift of love, and send your Spirit to come and illuminate your holy word. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. A reading from Psalm 13. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I bear pain in my soul and have sorrow in my heart all day long? How long shall my enemy be exalted over me? Consider and answer me, O Lord my God. Give light to my eyes, or I will sleep the sleep of death, and my enemy will say, I have prevailed. My foes will rejoice because I am shaken. But I trusted you, I trusted in your steadfast love. My heart shall rejoice in your salvation. I will sing to the Lord because he has dealt bountifully with me. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hear these words from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 10, verses 40 through 42. Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. Whoever welcomes a prophet in the name of a prophet will receive a prophet's reward, and whoever welcomes a righteous person in the name of a righteous person will receive the reward of the righteous. And whoever gives even a cup of cold water to one of these little ones in the name of a disciple, truly, I tell you, none of these will lose their reward. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. It is good to be with you again here in Boca Grande. It's always a wonderful surprise and almost shocking when I come across the bridge and just am reminded of the tremendous beauty of this place and of its people. So thank you so much for inviting me, and to Pastor Matthew for inviting me today to share with you again and enjoy the beauty and the tranquility of this place. I pray that that God would join us in these moments in a special way this morning. And so would you join me in that prayer as we offer this time afresh to God. Holy and loving God, you alone are worthy of our praise, our adoration, and our affections. And we thank you for these sacred moments, knowing that we did not come here and ask for you to join us here, but that you were already here working and waiting for us to come to you. God, we thank you for your grace in these moments and pray that you would work in us in a powerful way, and that you would work through us in a powerful way, that all of creation would know your abundant life. Work in me as I share these thoughts and reflections, and work in all of us together that we might together please you and bring you honor, and that we might do no harm. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Well, greetings from Fort Myers and from the campus ministry that is your mission at Florida Gulf Coast University, and also serving students at Florida Southwestern University as well. We are grateful to be a mission extension of who you are, and bringing as much of the church to folks on campus as we possibly can, so that they have easier access to learn how beloved they are and how cherished they are and how they can participate in the good things that God is doing. This morning, the psalmist speaks to us and begins with a lament that many of us feel profoundly right now, right? How long, O Lord, how long are we going to need to continue to endure under these circumstances? How long will the suffering continue? How long will the spread continue to increase? How long will be in tense relationship with one another across our nation? How long will there be some who are in and some who are out, some who have much and many, many who have nearly nothing? And whenever we hear the psalmist, I think, in the scriptures say those words, how long, O Lord, and it connects us to our own experiences of challenge, of suffering, of struggle, or to our own experiences and observations of others who are experiencing long given struggle. It challenges and calls upon our hope muscles, doesn't it? Spiritually calls us to grow in our faith, in our trust, in our hopefulness. But how do we cultivate that? What do we do to continue to fuel and feed that hope, if not to continue to trust in the one who is the author of a very, very big story? Because if we find ourselves rooted in this time and place, and only in this time and place, we would be lost. We would be frustrated. We would certainly feel hopeless. But because as people of faith, we connect to a God who replants us, relocates us, reframes our perspective into an eternal narrative, we have hope. And hope becomes more than just a noun. It becomes more than just a virtue. It actually becomes a verb. And we become people who are hoping actively that one day, it should come to pass that there would be no more crying and no more pain, that there would be no more suffering and no more disconnection in our world, one from another, group from a group, nation from a nation, humanity from the rest of creation. I want you to think for just a moment how our predominant culture of individualism and self-empowerment has affected our faithfulness and the narrative we tell ourselves, the story we tell ourselves about who God is and how God works. It's important that we understand ourselves as unique beings, but it's also important for us to plant ourselves in a story that has us in connection with all other things. For what if God's will is bigger for me than my individual soul's care apart from the rest of creation? So often we speak of things like welcoming people into the abundant life or welcoming people into the relationship of salvation as an individual decision they make, as if God is not the primary actor, as if God's grace doesn't meet them there and call them there and join them there long before they even arrive, before we even arrive in that moment. What if God's will for our understanding of salvation is bigger than our own acceptance of God's grace and the transformation of just our own heart? But what if it is that plus an invitation to feel connected and apart and in action, hoping with the rest of creation? I think it speaks to this beautiful relationship that we have with God being both immanent and transcendent. Because God does care for us individually. God does love us and claim us as God's children individually. And also, God is also above and over all things, eternal in nature, able to see all of the pictures at one time that we can only see in bits and pieces. God is caring for us at the same time caring for everything else and the salvation of all of it. What if we were able to reframe and rethink the way we talk about the faith that we share and the urgency that we have to share that faith, knowing that we have been loved in a way that's transformed us and we want that love to be known, but what if we could think of it in a different way? That the love that transforms each of us connects all things to God in this giant story of life that is an experience of a bigger connection than we ever thought was possible. How would our hymnody change? How would our praises and our prayers change? How would the things that we long for when we think of suffering and how long we have to endure it, how would those things change? And what might we do to interact in the midst of all of that? You see, Reverend Dr. James Cone says it this way: the gospel of Jesus is not a rational concept to be explained in a theory of salvation, but rather a story about God's presence in Jesus' solidarity with the oppressed, which has led to his death on the cross. And so what is redemptive is the faith that God snatches victory out of defeat and death and hope out of despair. I believe this: we are not just saved from something when we put our faith and our trust in Jesus Christ. We are not saved only from something, but we are saved to something and for something. We are saved to partner with God, to join God in the mutual work of reconciliation and restoration and healing of all creation so that the universe can be once again the way God dreamed it could be in Eden. To see God's original vision be restored. This is what we are saved to and what we're saved for. A vision of the world and the universe where all of God's creatures have enough and where there is no more crying and where there is no pain. Where there is safety for everyone and everything God has made. Cone also says this: the healing of the sick, the feeding of the hungry, giving sight to the blind, meant that Jesus did not regard salvation as an abstract spiritual idea or simply a feeling in the heart, but that salvation is the granting of physical wholeness within the concreteness of pain and suffering. Liberation, then, cannot be separated from the historical struggle of freedom in this world. You see, salvation is not just an escape hatch, a plan for someday far off that isn't here yet, although that does often give us hope to think of it that way. But salvation invites us to a life not just of orthodoxy or right belief, but also into orthopraxy and right practice, right action. Salvation cannot be removed from the suffering of the planet. It cannot be separated from our work to bring justice for our neighbors, because that is the scale of God's gracious love for this world. That one day every knee should bow and every tongue confess that Jesus is God, not as a dividing line between people who are in and people who are out, not as a wall that defines who is included and who is excluded, but rather as a definition of who God loves and how God loves, and as a sign of the restoration that God intends to bring to all of us and to everything God has made. Pema Chodron says, "Compassion is threatening to the ego. We might think of it as something warm and soothing, but it's actually very raw. When we set out to support other beings, when we go so far as to stand in their shoes, when we aspire to never close down to anyone, we quickly find ourselves in the uncomfortable territory of life not on my own terms." So here, the discomfort of the psalmist, who in the midst of lament pivots and turns back to praise. But notice that when the writer makes this shift from how long, O Lord, and will it be true that my enemies would prevail against me? When the psalmist makes this shift, it isn't to say, I trust in my own steadfast love. I rejoice in my salvation. No, that's not what the psalmist says. Rather, the writer says, I rejoice, God, in your salvation. Hear in these words the unity of the gospel, saying that whatever room we make to love each other is room that we make to love Christ. It's not that salvation in Christ isn't personal. It's intensely personal. And it matters immensely when we turn our hearts and our minds toward Christ and allow ourselves to be renewed and restored, and we allow the Holy Spirit to reorient our sensibilities to the will and the way of God. It matters immensely that we follow, or that we allow ourselves to feel in full the powerful and tremendous love of God for us deep in the marrow. But let us also remember that grace is something God initiates. A part, even the central part, of God's narrative, which is a story that is much, much bigger than any single one of us. God's salvation is about so much more than a soothing balm for our own soul or that escape plan from the hell we experience here on earth to a place that's somewhere far away from here and far away from now. God's salvation begins right now in an invitation to partner with God in putting an end to the prayers of suffering. How long? How long, O Lord? An end to the prayers of the poor, of the marginalized, of the overlooked, of the forgotten, of the outcasts who cry out again and again and again. It is for this, it is to this, that we are saved. It is in this awareness that what creates the most abundance for me is doing the very things, is being the very things that create the most abundance for you, that we find our real salvation. And we don't have to wait until we're gone from this earth to experience that taste of heaven, because God is inviting us right now to bring the kingdom of God right here upon the earth. Will you pray with me? God, we thank you so much for all that you have done for us, for the way that you call us deep within our hearts, in places that feel like they are far isolated from the rest of the world, from anyone else. We thank you that you speak to us there. And we thank you that you also call us out from those quiet, still places, out into our communities, out into our families, out into our nation, out into our world, out into nature. And you ask us, by the power of your Holy Spirit, to see, to really see. So God, we pray this morning that you would open our eyes to the fullness of your salvation, not just for what we need for ourselves, but for how we might find abundant life by helping to create it for others. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Will you join me now in affirming our faith? Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare. We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of the Father's unfailing grace, the ground of our hope, and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives, whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the truth of Christ and find strength and help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in the service of love as set forth in the example of our blessed Lord, to the end that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth. Amen.
Praises for Matthew.
Will you pray with me? Lord, we pray for our world, for those who find themselves in leadership, for those who've experienced suffering, for those who feel disconnected. And for those who grieve today, God, we lift up these prayers to you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray this morning for our nation, that in our own home there are those who do not feel at home. We pray for the hurt that we have done to one another. We pray for care in this time of physical healing and for the nurturing of relationships, that your great physician power would come to us. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray for those among us who feel as if they have no voice. And we pray for those who have influence and platforms and authority and wring their hands wondering what they can say and how they can help. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray for the families of this community, for those who are being impacted by all the different conditions that we find ourselves in, that you would bring a sense of freedom and a sense of peace, that you would relieve anxieties and fears, and that you would call us more than ever to trust in your grace. Lord, in your mercy. Amen. And now will you join me in praying the Lord's Prayer as Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. This morning, you are already aware that offering baskets have been provided out in the narthex or at the entry to the sanctuary, and so we invite you to share your gifts there as you come and go, if you have not already. And will you join me as we pray to the Lord? Gracious and loving God, whose property is always to have mercy and whose will is ever directed to your children's good, we thank you that you have generously poured out yourself time and time again in sacrificial love for us. And so we pray together as we have time in enjoying this music and enjoying quiet at this moment, that you might fill us with a sense of abundance and a sense of generosity. And we thank you for these spiritual gifts. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God, may all that we have shared, our gifts, our time, our service, and our finances, be as if we had shared it directly with you. Multiply these gifts and make them useful in your kingdom and use them for your work. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. May the love of God, the grace of his Son, Jesus Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit be yours now and always. Amen.
Thank you. huge thanks for sharing your music today.
You're welcome. Thank you for being here and for your sermon.
Oh, yeah.
And for all the things you did during.